My name's Alex Campbell.
I'm Jeff.
And you're watching Examining the Expanse. So there's a great little character moment in not these episodes, but the previous episodes.
Yes.
Where most of the show is like hectic situations and extreme moments. We get this nice little character moment with Alex, mm-hmm. just seeing him in his downtime. Mm-hmm. He's drinking energy drinks or beers.
It's not
or...
quite clear, yeah.
Yeah.
There's some sort of...
He seems inebriated though.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's listening to like Hank Williams because there's a part of Mars.
Texan? Yeah, they're like
southern.
Indian Texans. That's, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, I remember it explaining it in the book when Mars was first colonized. There was a big...
Yeah, there's a bunch of Texans, a bunch of Indians, basically, the two cultures merged.
So yeah, that's interesting. And yeah, I like the whole scene, the feeling of it, and there's this great moment where he spins around, 2001 style, and the whole effect was in camera, they just removed the wire work. So it's great they got all these in-camera effects that are like blue screen or green screen or
it's
CGI.
A bit of screwy physics.
Yeah.
With the cans and stuff. Like it's not.
Yeah, well,
like he's got a can of drink and he like spills his drink. It's like that's not how.
Yeah, and then liquids like tries to catch it.
Function in zero gravity because of surface tension.
Yeah.
And liquid tends to cling to a surface.
Yeah.
And that comes up a fair bit in The Expanse when people get like badly injured because if you like, say for instance, if you vomit,
yeah,
that's gonna stay.
It's gonna stay on you. Mm.
Or if you're bleeding profusely, especially from the face, that's gonna stay on your face. It's not gonna go anywhere.
Yeah, I remember old mate, the medic, lost his head, the pool of blood just like pooled around here. And then when they went back to 1G, it was just like...
Yeah,
it's nice to see a little character moment where it's not an extreme situation.
Mm-hmm.
I remember there's this girl, Comic Book 19, she has like YouTube reviews or whatnot.
Okay.
She was always commenting on the X-Men films where you never got to see them in their downtime, like having fun and being themselves and interacting. They're always like fighting somebody or in a fucking hectic situation.
Yeah.
And she really liked like them as characters just living their lives.
I mean, I don't know that those movies were particularly good movies.
At least 50% of them were garbage, but I have a fondness for them, Jasper. Oh. A
pretty
fondness.
Fucking horrible film.
Hey, when I was 9 years old, I brought out a live action X-Men film. I was fucking stoked. I watched it 2 times in a row, back to back. X-Men 1, and then like my mom's like, what do you want to get? I'm like, that exact same movie again, mom! Let's watch that shit again!
That's pretty bad.
I liked the X-Men. And then, yeah, we get this great sequence with Alex mapping out the Rocinante going through
the Jovian moons.
Yeah, slingshotting it with all the gravity of all the moons and not being picked up by the MCRN. And it's beautiful. I mean, this is a relatively low budget show, but they still managed to make it look beautiful. And it's a tense scene and exciting. Makes no scientific sense. Well, it does.
It's traveling fucking far.
It'd take a year to do what he did.
I don't know, but that's the case.
There was a guy that broke I guess knows things.
Yeah, presumably.
I'll put the link in the description for him.
Yeah.
He knows more than me, whether or not he knows what he's talking about is to be determined. But yeah, he said it's possible, but he mapped his trajectory. He's like, that'd take a year.
Yeah.
Which isn't a great, like, I'm gonna bail out my friends.
Well, like I said, it depends on, it's all, like, speed is relative, right? So it'll take you a year. It depends on what speed you're going at. But if this guy's, if he's only using, like, thrusters, I believe is what
That's
he said.
That's what he said, the little things.
I mean, yeah. I don't think so. But like, the physics of their drive engines is not really fully there. A lot of that's just hand wave for the sake of the
Yeah. Wave. But like the author said, it's like Wikipedia level research.
Yeah, yeah.
They're like, yeah, it kind of makes sense on the page. Mm. It's like when someone asks George R. R. Martin about how like winter could go for a decade, what is the orbit of this specific planet, specific sun? And he said, magic. What the fuck are you talking about? It's a book.
Yes.
It's fiction.
The purpose of this is it's a narrative.
Yeah. It's supposed to be entertained and engaged in the characters. Yeah.
But I still sort of think, like, if your internal consistency is at that point, then you've done something right.
Yeah.
Like, if the internal consistency is there to the point where you're nitpicking, you know, how specifically the fucking... their drive system works to allow them to travel these distances in the time frames that they do.
Yeah.
Then you're doing something right.
I mean, they obviously thought it out a lot.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, old man had like 3 years worth of fucking backstory before they even wrote a word. I watched his interview with them as well, and I told you about it. And yeah, they said that if Amazon was willing, they'd be keen to do 9 seasons.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think season 4 goes up to the end of book 5. But I guess they can make it up somewhere else and just keep on going.
I mean, like, I know what happens...
In book 8?
In like the next season, right?
I know. Have you read all the books up to book 8?
Yeah.
And there's one more to go.
I know what happens in the next... I know how the next season opens.
Mm.
I think we've had this conversation before.
It's possible. Don't spoil anything.
I'm not going to spoil anything, but it's like, I know what's coming at.
Yeah. I don't know if I want to do that, because I did that with Game of Thrones. I read all the books, and the books are amazing.
It's going to be amazing to see how they do it.
Mm.
Because they're like they haven't shied away from any of like the major points.
Mm.
You know, they didn't shy away from like the giant ring. I thought like they wouldn't do the giant molecule ring. They wouldn't do that. They'd bitch out and do something on a smaller scale because it would be easier for budget and yada yada yada. But they haven't. They haven't. They've hit all the major points and they've gone, now fuck it, we're gonna actually do.
Yeah. This is a mild spoiler for the books as well, and I don't want you to spoil it more for me. But the guy interviewing them also said there's like a 30-year gap in between two of the books.
Oh yeah, there's a, yeah.
Yeah, I know they were talking about writing the books for the sake of the books. Because they're like big writers on the show. I think they wrote the last episode of this season and they write like 3 or 4 episodes a season.
Yeah.
So like in the writer's room. So all the changes were like,
it's not like the book.
Was like, it's the fucking writers of the book in the writer's room. Yeah. Like, making changes because book to fucking television shows, completely different mediums. Yeah. And yeah, the guy was like, well, how are they going to do that on screen? Like, how are you going to accomplish that for a television show? And they were like, I don't know. We don't write the books for
show. They won't. It'll just be,
apparently,
there wasn't a giant gap.
Apparently that doesn't make sense for the narrative. That's what they said, at least. They said, you need the gap there.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think what they'll do is they'll hand wave it a little bit.
Yeah,
there's a bunch of characters that go away and accomplish a bunch of shit on screen.
They were gonna be 3 books.
No. Oh,
they were gonna, in that 30-year gap, they had 3 other books planned.
Oh really?
They planned a 9-book arc and then a 12-book arc.
Yeah.
And they looked at both of them and they looked at the 12-book arc and I said, nah, those 3 books suck.
Oh,
we won't do that.
Yeah,
we'll have a 30-year gap.
Yeah. So well, in that 30-year gap, there's like a bunch of shit happens off-screen that doesn't involve the crew of the Rocinante, basically.
Okay, yeah.
Right,
yeah.
Like a bunch of people sort of leave and go and do a thing and then come back.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, that might be what they're talking about, that it doesn't make sense that those people didn't have enough time to do the stuff that they do.
Yeah.
This is really ambiguous because I don't want to get into
I don't know spoilers. What you're talking about.
You don't
want to spoil it for me. Probably people watching this that haven't read the books that don't want to fucking hear about it. We should probably stop talking about it.
Dude, there's so much shit that fucking happened.
That interview.
There's so much shit.
It was like a 40-minute interview and I got 15 minutes into it. And the interviewer was like, so in book 8, you'll kill off, and I was like, nah! Exit exit. It's fascinating. I love them talking about the process of writing it in the writer's room and the novels and stuff, but then I was like, oh, no. Yeah, and this is like the peak of Holden's anti-hero arc. He goes through this whole trajectory from season one until now.
Yeah, in the series, as we've seen so far.
Yeah. He slowly gets darker and darker and allows Amos to kill more and more innocents and disintegrating children, and Amos is beating up people for cancer chicken, and he's holding Naomi back. And then he does this like great like Ahab thing in this episode where the proto-molecule is like the white whale, and he's on the hunt.
Sacrifice everything to get to the proto-molecule.
Yeah, revenge.
Yeah.
How far we're gonna take this, Jim? Got it! No, please! That is not your kid! Not anymore!
Revenge is a dish best served cold, an old Klingon proverb.
Yeah, did you see that Klingon video I posted today?
Yes, I did.
That was great.
It's like, someone went to the effort.
Apparently, it's not actually the... So it's a Klingon version of...
8 Mile?
Eminem's...
Lose Yourself? 8 Mile?
Without Me.
Oh.
You know, the song...
I'm not an Eminem fan. Well, no, I knew the song.
You know, the one, it's basically, I'm Back, the real...
Yeah.
That one. So much it took two men, Klingon hold dry. So much it took two men, Klingon hold dry. But apparently, none. It's like the lyrics are about like Klingon warriors. Like it's an original song done to the tune of Without Me by Eminem, entirely in Klingon. But apparently, the dude can actually do it live. Like it's a thing he does on stage.
Because he's
active within the Klingon speaking community, apparently.
There's this line in Star Trek VI where this Klingon warrior remarks that it's better to hear Shakespeare in its original Klingon tongue. He's implying that Shakespeare was Klingon or something, which is obviously fucking bullshit. And everyone's like, what the fuck are you talking about? So then, these bunch of fucking nerds. And I don't want to be mean, because we are a bunch of fucking nerds. D&D fucking nerds. They went about doing Hamlet, but in Klingon.
Yeah.
And added on the special features for this DVD, and I watched like 30 seconds of it. Fuck this. I can't do that. Same with that Lose Yourself thing. I mean, you've done a thing. That's all well and good.
Congratulations.
But I can't engage in this media in any sense.
That's
fair. after this, Holden, he realizes Ahab did not realize this at all. Ahab died.
No, well, he couldn't sacrifice Naomi. That was
it's not about revenge, it's about your friends.
Yes, he had to let go of his
revenge vendetta against the proto-molecule. He realized.
Yeah.
Realized
he grew as a person.
He did. He had a character arc. He changed. And now he's good boy Holden again.
Yeah.
Till he becomes fucking crazy.
Well, it was threatened to like fucking shoot a whole bunch of ships. It was saying the entirety of our arsenal rammed up your ass.
So
I don't know.
Any ship that opens fire on us will feel the sum total of our state-of-the-art Martian arsenal rammed up its ass.
And then, it just becomes an insane person with the fucking... his ghost.
Yeah, Miller following him around and shit.
There's a moment in season 4 where, like, you got the colony and you got, like, the typhoon coming in and the ships are all in orbit. They can't do anything because their fusion drives don't work anymore. Yeah. And he outlines the plan and this chick's just like, so you're saying we can't do anything. We just have to listen to everything you're saying because your fucking ghost is telling you to do this. And he's like... Yeah, that's exactly what I'm saying. You all need to stop, do exactly what I say, and believe in this fucking madness. So yeah, the third main beat of this two episodes is Naomi's, like, redemption for herself, I guess?
Yeah. Well, so... I can't remember when it's revealed in the books that she has a son. I feel like they've revealed it kind of early.
Yeah.
I don't think it was revealed this early in the books that she has a son.
Yeah.
Because, again... That's going to be a thing.
Well, the main villain of season 5 is her ex-partner.
Yeah.
They set that up in season 4.
Yeah, they did. That's true. So I'm not totally...
Yeah, and it ended on the big cliffhanger of him being like, I'm going to fuck shit up.
He's... Yeah. Yeah. That is a cliffhanger that they ended on.
Thank you, Jasper.
But, I don't know that you know what Naomi did. Do we know? I don't think.
No.
It's not been told.
All we know is.
Because I'm just trying to remember what I know from the books versus what I know from the series, so I don't accidentally say something.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we don't actually know. This isn't This isn't Naomi's redemption.
Okay.
Basically, yeah, she'd have to do a lot more work than this.
Yeah, she does hint that she's done dark stuff and that her partner took her kid and fucked off and.
Yeah.
I think she talked. There was like an explosion in a dock.
Again. Again. I don't want to spoil things.
This is a great review because we can't say anything about anything.
Well, I know what she's talking about.
Yeah. But like, she was going through this moment and she got to the point where like. Everything was out of control and Holden and fucking Amos were just off the fucking leash. She's like, I can't be part of this anymore. I need to fucking leave. And then she was guilty about Eros and the fact that they left everyone, which I don't know, they didn't really help everyone. So she herself needed to fucking save these people to feel good about herself.
Yes,
again.
Yeah.
Because she's just seeing Amos beat up people with a fucking cans of chicken. And yeah, this...
Well, she's starting to doubt whether or not following Holden is a good idea. She's watching him slowly go batshit fucking insane.
Yeah.
And she's going, okay, I need to get the fuck away from this guy.
Yeah, and then she immediately comes across a situation where she could help 52 people survive, but there's like 300 people there. So it's this great, like, emotional, dynamic situation that they set up.
I trusted you to repair my ship. Don't ask me to trust James Holden.
Are you telling me we have to leave all those people behind?
You want to walk down that line, look at every face, and decide who gets to live? You think they're going to let you do that?
We're not fucking leaving those people here.
I like it. It's good. And I like the idea of an unruly crowd, just like, in the crush. We've been in like a crowd in the crush.
Oh, no, yeah. It'd be fucking... That would have been hectic.
Yeah, and the idea of that is...
That big burly dude fighting off the crowd with the
And the captain of the ship and Amos are like, we need to fucking leave these people. Who gives a fuck? And she's like, fuck all of you. I'm not letting these people die. So all that dynamic is great. And then, yeah, I think the problem that both of us have is like when she actually goes out, and she talks to this like unruly, violent crowd of 300 people, and they talk them all into like forming into groups.
Yeah.
And then a select 52, which is randomly selected somehow through this process.
Yeah, they do this thing, and it's just not. I get why they were filming it the way they were filming it. Is to give you the sense of the people rather than just like one stream of people going through with like a flat shot of just like people walking in a line. They want to give you this sense of like, or each person sort of saying goodbye to their loved ones, so they're letting
it doesn't make a lot of fucking sense.
They would just count out 52 people and be like, you get to go inside, the rest of you have to stay here.
Well, she would have went out to the crowd and been like, hey, only 52 people can go, and they would have beat the fuck out of her and killed her. They wouldn't have counted out anybody, and they wouldn't have gotten under control.
Or what it would have been is like, there's 52 people couldn't come, right? Whoever's left, like, whoever can corral the crowd back and
make sure
there's 52 people here, we will take those 52 people.
Yeah.
And it would have been a bunch of dudes basically fist fighting to allow 52 people to get in.
That would have been cool.
Yeah, it would have turned into a skirmish. There would have been a fucking riot.
Yeah. But yeah, I like the tense situation that's set up, and like it's a clear like problem and solution scenario. And it's a nice like character beat for Naomi.
Mm.
Okay, I've been through this, I've done all this fucking shit, and I have saved people.
Mm.
Looks like we're clear.
It was cool to watch them like walking around the station as the station's shutting down around them.
That's a cool
concept, and it really does resonate with the concept that it was originally a tabletop RPG, because you've got like the party going through the dungeon.
It's
really got that kind of,
as it gets more and more hazardous, as
different
elements shut off and environmental
you
things.
You kick in a door and there's a bunch of dudes on the outside of the door, and then you
fight them.
You deal with that encounter, and then you have the next encounter. Yeah.
I love how Prax is there too, because he becomes the emotional like anchor for all this. Because if he wasn't there, it's like, who the fuck cares
they
about that little
girl? Well, they would have been murder hobos.
Yeah. But he's the one like, no.
Yeah.
They're experimenting on these fucking children. I need to save my little girl.
Yeah.
And to the Rocinante crew's credit, like, they are good people. They are like, we will help you save your daughter. It fulfills our wishes as well, and we'll kill innocents to do it. But we will help you find your kid. And then you've got him there reacting. So you got all the emotional beats with that character. Because without him, it's just like.
Yeah.
They don't give a fuck.
You need that sort of fish out of water at this point.
He does become a fleeting but interesting new member of the Rocinante.
That's true.
Fits in nice.
Yeah.
All that little positions, and he's the plant guy.
He's the plant guy.
He does plant related stuff.
That's his superpower.
Photosynthesis. Amos can beat the fuck out of people. He can grow some plants. Soybeans.
He makes those panels.
He does. I think they just get wrecked.
They do.
Leaves. And then they don't redo them. They're like, bye, Prax. You've got your daughter. You're done.
Yeah.
Why kill it? It's such a base human instinct to destroy things we don't understand.
Don't talk down to me, plant guy.
So it's worth mentioning, this is the second time that we've filmed this review.
That film shall never see the light of day.
Well, that video that we filmed. We were at your place, and members of your family came over.
It turned into like a dinner party.
Yeah. A dinner party where we drank a bottle of scotch, and then half a bottle of vodka.
A liter bottle of scotch, and then half a liter.
Thought we could sit down and review The Expanse. We filmed like 45 minutes of material, and I came back home and watched it and was like, what the fuck is this? It was just fucking... chaos!
Yeah.
Here's a small clip of it. So this sequence, right?
No. The first thing we need to talk about.
Rocinante.
Right. What was that sci-fi fucking film?
Mike Tyson.
No, sci-fi film. Ender's Game.
Isaac Asimov. And then Stanley
Kubrick.
Have you
read any of the Expanse?
Listened to fucking Rendezvous with Ramus right here.
Rendezvous with Ramus.
Yeah, we listened to the whole
thing. Rendezvous with Rima, and that's not Isaac Asimov.
Who was it?
I'm
gonna get rid of this fucking thing. And then at the end of the episode, I'll give you the full 7 minutes. The rest was all garbage.
Not my proudest moment.
No! I mean, I made like 230 reviews. There's never been one where I've been like, nah, this has failed. This is not happening. Like, Mark and I have done ones where we've been fucking drunk.
Yeah.
But I released it.
We were.
But
we were misbehaving.
It was incoherent.
Yeah.
It didn't make any sense. It wasn't, one of the main factors was that it wasn't a review of The Expanse.
That's fair.
So if I had released it as a review of Here There Be Dragons, then people would have clicked on it and been like...
Yeah, that's fair.
You people are fucked. Which I'll probably also think when they click onto this review.
Mean.
But less so. There's a little moment where Bobby and Avasarala and old mate come on to Jules Pierre Mao's yacht, and one of the guys is like, "Hey, there's little sandwiches here if you want them." And Bobby just starts shoving them.
That was great.
Yeah, that's a great little character moment.
Yeah.
Do you like cucumbers?
I was going to ask you where you got those lovely couches, but I don't want to run out of sparkling conversation.
Steve's in love with her, eh? He wants to kiss her on the mouth, Jasper.
I mean, that doesn't surprise me.
Yeah, so basically, in conclusion, once again, the writers are able to tell coherent character arcs.
It's a good show. It's a good show. I don't know.
Set up interesting, intense environments.
It's got everything. Fucking, what more do you want?
What more do you want? Guess what I rewatched?
What did you rewatch?
The Lord of the Rings.
Really?
And that's what it was.
Was it mediocre?
It was good. And I rewatched that 18-hour documentary on the making of it.
we're gonna have to sit down to a marathon of the extended Lord of the Rings on the big projector.
Yeah, It was lightning in a bottle, like.
That's
what I came away from watching that 18-hour documentary. Like, it was just lightning in a fucking bottle. Yeah. Right time, right place. And watching how they made it, you really understand how, like, low budget and,
well,
like...
Well, this is... It was sort of like...
Pardon me.
They had... Because of where they were, right? They could call upon people like blacksmiths and, like, fucking proper weaponsmiths.
Dude,
model makers.
You would jizz your pants watching this thing, eh? Watching these people make these fucking...
The Weta Studios is amazing.
And every like establishing shot of things in that is a fucking model.
But all these people before this were not...
They were craftsmen.
Yeah.
And Peter Jackson said, we're doing this thing. Do you want to come and build all these swords for us? And this fucking podung bald guy with a ponytail was like, okay.
Well, because there was all these people in... New Zealand, yeah. Who were like medieval enthusiasts and shit.
Yeah, and he got like Alan Lee and John Howe, who were like Tolkien artists. Who'd been doing the arts for Tolkien for like 20 years.
Hey,
come and be conceptual artists for this. And they worked on the film for 7 fucking years.
Uh-huh.
It was like 3 years before they even started filming. And then it took them a year to film it because they filmed it all at once. They filmed all 3 movies at once. Went for like 18 months or something.
Yeah.
Then after that, they released each movie 1 year after the other. So they were there the whole time. It's like, hey, can we get a sketch of like the Black Gate? Hey, what do the fucking eagles look like? And it was just, it's incredible, amazing, lightning in a bottle. Then you go to The Hobbit. And I watched a documentary for that as well, and it's great, because it's so just fucking open and honest.
Yeah.
And Lord of the Rings was like 3 years pre-production, and planning, and meticulous.
The Hobbit was, we need 3 movies now.
Director, Guillermo del Toro, or whatever the fuck his name is, he pulled out, and it was like 2 months before shooting. And Peter Jackson was like, I'll do it. Because he was going to be like producer. He didn't want to do it.
Yeah.
And like he sat down and looked through all the stuff. And he's like, this isn't a Peter Jackson film.
No.
I can't in good conscience sit down and make this. This is a Guillermo del Toro film. Threw it all out. And instead of 3 years pre-production, you got 2 months.
So it's just all CGI.
Yeah. Well, they just didn't know what the fuck they were doing.
Yeah.
Assembling the cameras and like putting the cameras together and figuring out how to use the cameras. And it's like, next day we're filming. It's like people on there. It's like, what is happening here? What is going on? It's like, I don't know. Peter Jackson's like sitting down with the actors, workshopping like what their lines should be and shit. And to his credit, like I didn't come away like going, you fucking hack. I came away loving the guy more and more.
Oh, yeah.
Because he's like jovial dancing around. And he's like, this happened. I took it on and now we're doing it. I don't give a fuck. He's dancing around, shoeless, fat as fuck, being Peter Jackson.
Fair enough.
But yeah, the movies are garbage.
What's that film that he made about the zombies?
Brain Dead or something.
Brain Dead, yeah.
Well, he was...
Have you seen that?
Yeah, I
have. That's a movie.
Yeah, he was like a B-film, like, slasher, horror, gore guy.
I don't know why the fuck he got The Lord of the Rings.
He said, like, he read it in high school and he thought this will make an amazing movie.
I mean, and everybody who's read any of those sorts of books.
And then he got to 30 and he's like, but why hasn't anyone made a movie?
Who reads those books first goes, this would make a fucking amazing movie. And then they go, oh, yeah, no, you couldn't make this. No, it's like trying to adapt Dune.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, we'll see. The end of the year. Maybe if cinemas are open.
We'll see. They will have made the film at least, so they'll have to eventually release it.
Just on the Netflix. Yeah. Half of the first book. Alright, thank you for watching me. Guys, like, subscribe, and close those with the facts around opinions I don't avoid. Thank you and good night. Now get ready for 7 minutes of garbage nonsense.
What are you drinking? Are you drinking it with Coke? I was just gonna drink it.
I'll probably pour another shot.
We need to show the camera a shame that we like advertising our alcoholism is like the, I don't know.
So the sequence, right?
No. The first thing we need to talk about, Rocinante. Right? What was that sci-fi fucking film?
Mike Tyson.
No, sci-fi film. Ender's Game.
Isaac Asimov. And then Stanley.
Have you read any Isaac Asimov?
Yeah, we listened to fucking Rendezvous with Ramus right here.
Rendezvous with Ramus.
Yeah, we listened to the whole.
Rendezvous with Rima, and that's not Isaac Asimov. I'm gonna get rid of this fucking thing.
Didn't he film the space launch, Jasper?
Oh, an image of a photo of Kubrick in a dune on the moon.
We should review Dr. Strangelove or How I Learned.
How have we not reviewed Dr. Strangelove?
I feel like that's been on the list for like 3 years.
Have you watched that movie?
What do you mean? We watched it together.
Did we?
Of course we did.
I remember the
first time. We watched every movie together, Jasper!
What the fuck is this?
Yeah, he gets up in the chair. I remember getting up in the chair.
My theater, I can walk!
There's a clip. Pizza. Right there. Someone needs to clip that, please.
Monsieur! I can walk! My theater, I can walk!
I hope in God you cut that out. That would be embarrassing.
And then after that, he uses the gravity of all the moons of Jupiter to like slingshot himself.
Look, it's fine if the Expanse needs to take liberties for the point of the narrative, okay?
Science fiction is in fiction and science. We only take one of the words for meaning, and that specific word is not the word fiction, it's the word science, and science is what we take!
It's it's entirely dependent on the scene, on the situation, and on how much emotional investment you have in the narrative. I apologize. That was unprofessional. I apologize.
No, yeah, I agree with you completely.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm a massive fan of
fiction!
And what fiction does is it takes moments of reality and it skews and changes them to make them more entertaining for the sake of a narrative, which is what I'm on board for, the exciting, engaging narrative. And just because Alex uses the slingshot gravity effects of the moon of Jupiter to bounce down.
This is not in the episode we're supposed to review.
Undetected by the MCRM to save the crew. And in real life, if that actual trajectory took a year, and within the actual episode it did not take a year, it doesn't mean that it's not an exciting action sequence, because it is.
Monsieur! Second one!
I'm gonna get rid of this fucking thing.
Holden goes through this great arc of character of hero to anti-hero within this episode.
Yeah, he's trying to be a badass.
Yeah.
He's a little guy. He's little.
Is he that little though?
No, look at the actor. I'm pretty sure he's pretty short.
in comparison to who?
Maybe I'm projecting onto the actor that described in the book.
I feel like you're watching him like he's gotta be short.
He looks
Please
like
he's God, he's gotta be short.
If that guy was like 6 foot, I would feel very inadequate.
Every time I watch him, I'm horribly emasculated.
It's understood.
Like distinct and defined tits. Like massive tits. Like there's a scene with him and Naomi naked where his tits are bigger than Naomi's. He has huge tits.
It would have just been nice if they just lingered a little bit more on the existential horror of humans trapped in metal boxes trying desperately to escape the vacuum of space. I don't nearly have this bottle of vodka, right?
The guy, whatever his name is, Quaaluf. The Moby Dick guy. He's a caricature, I'm not being racist. Wait, this has been like 40 minutes of our life, Jasper. How much do you want to review a 40-minute episode of television? Long
time. We haven't even got to Avasarala and like her altercations with Julie Mao. We haven't even started talking about fucking
all of that stuff. You can talk about that if you want.
I'm just saying, we've only talked about half the episode. The Wheel of Time.
I haven't read The Wheel of Time, but it ends
in the most lamest way to possibly ever end.
Just tell me, I don't give a fuck.
He rides off into the sunset. Literally. Like the main hero for like 13 books. Right? Just rides off into the sunset. And that's the end.
The sad but yet satisfying conclusion where your hero dies and nothing is fulfilled.
Yeah, you just want the slow descent into madness.
Yeah.
You know, we don't appreciate hero stories where the hero gets away with it. No. We take pleasure in the fact that we can't measure up to these hero archetypes, so therefore we take pleasure in their downfall.
That's why we relate so much
to That's why James Holden has to be short.
Well, I'm not sure that he's actually that short in real life. That's you. I think he's fucking 6 foot tall and ripped as fuck. And just nailing Naomi like there's no tomorrow.
Nah.